Spectrasys gives errors and warning messages. If you have an error, the program will typically stop. Here we show a warning message from Spectrasys that indicates that the LO amplifier has been driven into compression. The 1 dB compression point, as we'll see, is about 16 dBm, and we're driving it harder than that, such that the element gain is now down to about 28.5 dBm or dB. We can also, a very powerful feature, is we can probe the schematic at any point and determine what is going on. So if we put our cursor here and do an info balloon, we can see that the power level is about 16.588 dBm, which is well above the 1 dB compression point. More importantly, we can probe at the mixer LO input and determine the signal level there. And we'll see there, because of the filtering, that the signal level is about 10.8 dBm, which is almost exactly our desired level of 11. And most of the energy is from the fundamental. The other harmonic or intermod products are down at least 60 dB, so they're of no consequence to this. So this means that we can save time and not do any kind of rework that might have been necessary if we had looked at it without being able to look at this very easily, thus making our debugging much more efficient. Next, we're going to talk about doing a tabular display with the program. We can generate tables, and we can add a new table. Here we're adding one from scratch, adding a table. And we're going to look at this table, and what we're looking here is a budget table consisting of signal power at each node in the system, and we're going to add another parameter to here. You can see all the listings of many parameters available. And we're going to add dynamic range to here. So that adds another measurement. And the cascaded gain. And we can also write in a data file if we want to, and write out a text file, which we could then export or read into Excel. So we could take our budget output, or level diagram as it's called, and we could export this directly into Excel. Here we have the node names, the part names, the channel power, the dynamic range, and the cascaded gain of the system. So the overall cascaded gain is about 32 dBm. The dynamic range is about 34 dBm. Next, we're going to modify our system and implement a broadband source. So what we're going to do is we're going to delete the CW source. And select from the library of parts, which I'll show here briefly, show you how to, and then add a wideband source. And we can define the center frequency, which in our case we're going to make defined by the variable freq RF in gigahertz. And we're going to make the power level a function of the RF power level. And we're going to define the bandwidth as a variable bandwidth, again in gigahertz, as we saw previously in the equation block. And all we have to do is hit simulate and look at the results. And what you see here is there's the fundamental product as we looked at before. There are some other products. For instance, third order products, you can see are wider than fundamental products. There's the LO, which is a single frequency, since we're not tracking. So it allows us to quickly identify what type of components that are being shown there. So far what we've done is we've shown how to run Spectrasys, we've learned how to load and review the design, simulate its performance looking at noise, spectral analysis, budget. We've looked at spectral propagation and root cause analysis. We've looked at nonlinear effects such as intermodulation and dynamic range analysis. And we've changed the RF source from a single tone to a broadband source and displayed the results. Next, we're going to talk about WhatIF. Normally, WhatIF would be used in the front end of a job to help find the spur-free IF frequencies and identify problem spurs that might cause issues with our design. It can support up to 1 to 5 parallel mixers for modeling single-channel or multi-band radios with a common IF. You can use a generic double-balance mixer or read in any one of a number of Eagleware or commercial mixers. Normally, WhatIF would be used on the front end of the job to help find, again, the spur-free IF. In this case, we're going to look back at our design and see how WhatIF might have been applied in our case. Starting WhatIF from the desktop icon or from ADS, we can do it either way using the program. And when you come up with a Getting Started display on the screen, you can click on the WhatIF Frequency Planner icon. Here we have a low side mix where we have our RF center frequency is 200 megahertz, RF bandwidth and IF bandwidth are both 30 megahertz, and our drive level is 10 dBm. You notice down in the bottom here, it shows the LO frequency range as being 130 megahertz. So this is again a low side mix. If we look over here, we can see here's our desired band, and you can see that we have frequencies overlapping. So we have some in-band power levels that are approximately a 3x5 product and a 1x2 product that are folding over the top of our signal. What if we now convert it to a high side mix instead of a low side mix, which is the way it was in our design? It's simply a matter of just changing this preference up here. And we can see that now the spur products are down approximately 65 dB. And again, it's a 3x2 product that's folding over into our passband. So it's much better response. What we're doing here is showing that the program can be used to select different spur-free bands. You see these green arrows are areas where there are spur-free regions.